Mike Kent, San Jacinto College, moving on to another video talking about how to work with if statements. In this example called nested ifs, I'm going to solve a classical computer science, computer programming example where we need to see if the user has typed in a number grade that is either an A, a B, a C, a D, or an F. Now I've done it with a nested if using else if, which is under this button, which looks quite nice. I've got the ugly version of the nested if, and then I've also got the case statement to show you. Let me run the program here, show you what it does. So I can type in a grade like 76 and say get grade, that's a C. I can type in an 85, get grade, that's a B. I can type 50, which is an F, and of course what I want everybody to get is a 92, because that's an A. Now I'm going to hit exit here. I'll show you one more twist. I've got a new twist, a new version of the message box, which lets me put yes, no buttons on it, so the user can choose whether they really want to do this or not. I'm going to say yes, exit the program. Let's look at the code window. So I'm going to go into get grade. I'm going to double click on this, bring up the code window. First thing you'll see is I've dimmed two local variables, sub-level variables that are only in this sub. Desnum as a decimal, that's going to hold the number grade from the text box, and then I'm going to put the letter grade A, B, C, D, or F into this string called str for string grade. I'm going to do a try catch, like you were shown in an earlier chapter, to look for bad input. So I'm going to try to parse txtnum.txt as a decimal. If it does turn into a nested decimal, it'll go into desnum. Otherwise, that'll get caught. So I can give the user an error message saying, please enter a number. Put the focus on the text box that's causing the error. And then finally, I can say exit sub to make my program jump down to the end sub at the end of this subroutine. Now, let's look at the code for the nested if. So what I'm doing here is a series of ifs and elses. I check my first condition, which is checking for an A. If desnum is greater than or equal to 90, then if that's true, I'm going to set string grade to the letter A. Now, if the then is true, it's going to do the then. It's not going to go down to the else at all. So then it's just going to skip to the end if the first then is true. If the first then turns out to be false, if this first if statement is false, it's going to go on to the else. So what does the second else do? It says, is it greater than or equal to 80? Well, if that's true, it'll set it to B. Else, it'll check to see if it's a C. Okay, if that's true, it'll set it to C. Else, it'll check and see if it's greater than 60, which would be a D. And then finally, if it's not an A, B, C, or D, it must be an F, so we set it to F. Last thing we do is we put the answer into my label named label answer, which is spelled phonetically as opposed to the way we always spell answer. That's what I named it, and I'm sticking to my story. Now, let's look at a couple other things up here, because some people would tend to do this when they're writing their code. They could go if desnum greater than or equal to 80 and desnum less than 90. Let's think about this. Is this second condition really necessary? Okay, we don't have to check to see if it's less than 90 right here, because it will never get here unless it was less than 90. If it's greater than 90, it's going to do the first if statement. It's going to be up here. It's going to be true. So we don't have to check for this because we're cleverly checking the grades in numeric order from highest to lowest. So I'm going to set a breakpoint right here so we can see this code in operation. I'll click my breakpoint, red circle in the gray bar. Now you see the red line. I'm going to run my program. And let's enter in a 75. And I'll say get grade. So that's going to hit my breakpoint. My program's now paused. you can see that the tri-catch worked because it made it down to here. And I have a 75. Is 75 greater than 90? No. So remember on the debug menu, step over is F10. So I'm going to hit F10 to step down to the next line of code. So now it's going to check and see, is desnum greater than or equal to 80? No, that's going to be false. It's going to go on to the else. I'm going to hit my single step code button, F10. Is it greater than or equal to 70? Well, 75 is greater than or equal to 70. That's going to be true. It's going to set the grade to C. Now, because this one's true, it's going to skip the other two else's. So you see how it jumped down to the end if? I'm going to put the grade in the label. I'm going to come back up here at the top and say continue. So now you see we got a C. So this is the nice code, all right? This is the clean code. I'm going to click here and get rid of my breakpoint. I don't need it anymore. And the advantage of writing your if statements this way is they don't get nested inside of each other. Now what I want to do next is show you the ugly code. So if I come into ugly code, you can see I'm doing the same things. I've got the same two variables, one to hold the number grade as a number, one to hold it as a string. I've got the exact same try catch, but look at the if statement now. Now I'm saying if it's greater than or equal to 90, set it to an A, that's exactly the same. Else, then inside the else, I have another if statement. And that if statement has its own else. And then I have another if statement that's tabbed over, it has its own else. And then I have the fourth if statement checking for D, else it's an if. Now when I do it as separate if statements, each if statement has to have an end if. So this end if goes with this if right here. This end if right here goes with the one above it. This one goes with the one above it. This one goes with the one above it. So I've got to have four different end ifs for each one of my if statements. So this code gets quite ugly quite fast. It does exactly the same thing as this code right here, which is easier to understand and easier to work with. So once again, I'll put a breakpoint right here on the first if statement, run my program, and I'll put in the same grade. I'll put in a 75, if I can type right. There we go, 75. And this time I'm going to click on ugly code. So remember, I can hit F10 to step through the code. No, it's not an A. It goes to the second if. No, it's not greater than 80. It goes to the else. Goes to the third if. Yes, it is greater than 70, so it sets the grade to C. So it's not going to do the else, which makes it hit the end if. End if, end if, then it sets the grade into the label. I'll tell my program to continue, and you can see the grade was C. All right, now I'll turn off this breakpoint, go back to my form window, and double click on the case statement. Now, the case statement is another way to do the exact same thing that we did with the nested ifs. So, students ask me, why do we have multiple ways to do something? Every programming language I've seen has more than one way to solve a problem. Which way is best? Not necessarily one over the other. To me, it's whichever one is easiest to read and easiest to maintain. So in this case, I'm using all this code up here is identical to what we saw before, but here I'm using select case. Select case desnum. So we're looking at num. If its value is greater than or equal to 90, set the grade to A. If its value is greater than or equal to 80, set the grade to B, etc., etc., etc. And finally, I have case else as my catch-all, and that's where we set it to F. The select case is pretty nice in Visual Basic. There's something very, very similar in C++. It's called the switch statement, and it's much more limited than in Visual Basic. The switch statement in C++ will only let you check for one value, not a range. So here I can say case is greater than or equal to 90. In C++, I could just say 90. So that's not practical to use a case statement to solve this problem in C++, but you get those dialect differences. Last thing I need to show you in this program is the exit button, where it asks you, do you want to exit, yes or no? So I'm going to double click on exit, and I have to dim a variable to hold the result from the message box, and that has to be dimmed as a dialog result because we're getting a result from the dialog box. So let's look at what we have to do with messagebox.show. First thing I'm going to do is say, are you sure you want to exit? That's the message on the message box. This is the title on the message box. It's separated with a comma. And then the third thing I have to tell it is, what buttons do I want on that message box? And so when this message box runs, the user's going to click yes or no, and the result's going to get put into dialog yes, no. Then we have to have an if statement. If dialog yes, no is equal to yes, actually, technically, it's windows.forms.dialogresult.yes, then we want to close the program. Now, that's a lot of typing. So here's the good news. This is a lot of typing, too. But if I'm writing my message box and I hit comma, look how it pops up my choices. So I want yes, no. I'm going to double click on that, then hit my close parenthesis. And when I'm writing this if statement, when I say dialog yes, no equals, look at the choices it gives me. There's yes right there. I'm going to double click on it, add the word then. So fortunately, we don't have to memorize all of these. We just have to get to the point when we're writing the code and it'll pop up our choices. I'm going to put a breakpoint right here so we can see this message box run. I'm going to run the program, and I'm going to go straight to the exit button. Now, it paused right here. Yes, no doesn't have anything in it. As soon as I run this line of code, it's going to pop up the message box and say, are you sure you want to exit? Well, I'll say no. So now you can see dialog yes, no has a no in it. So it's going to skip over the then part, and it's not going to close the program. So if I tell my program to continue, this time I'll say exit. When I tell it to run the message box, it'll pop up. This time I'll say yes. You can see dialog yes, no has a yes in it. So when I get down to the if statement, it's going to do the me.close and end the program. So this is all I wanted to show you today. Remember, this is the bad way to write your nested if. It's ugly, doesn't look nice, it's hard to follow, versus if you use the else if construct, it's much easier to read, it's much easier to understand what's going on, and being a good programmer is about writing your code so it's easy to understand. Thanks a lot, folks. Got one more video on if statements to follow.